Well, Pastor Carlos began by talking about the harvest of the earth. And the reason he started talking about the second coming, when you look at Revelation chapter 14, where you find the three angels' messages, it's really divided up into three sections. From Revelation 14:14 through to the end of the chapter is a description of the second coming of Christ. And that's what we've studied previous. But if you look from verse 1 through to verse 5 in Revelation chapter 14, you have a description of a group of people called the 144,000. And then immediately following the description of the 144,000, the next thing that you see is the first angel's message. And that's a message that has to go to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. That is the everlasting gospel. And then it unfolds the second angel and the third angel. So there's really three sections that we find in Revelation chapter 14. We have the 144,000 from verse 1 to 5, the three angels' messages starting in verse 6 through to verse 13, and then you have the harvest of the earth starting in verse 14 through to the end of the chapter. So before we even get into the heart of the three angels' messages, we're going to spend a few moments now talking about the 144,000. There is a feature that we find in the book of Revelation is, it's sort of a tell what we're going to talk about, and then back up and explain a little bit more about how we got to that. Let me explain. Revelation 14, 1 to 5 talks about the 144,000, and it describes this group of people standing with the Lamb on Mount Zion. So that's a description of them victorious in heaven. And then you have the three angels' messages, and then you have the second coming of Christ. So before we even get into the three angels' messages and the second coming of Christ, you get a picture of this group of people who are taking the three angels' messages to the world. It begins by describing them victorious, standing with the Lamb on Mount Zion in heaven. So we actually jump forward in Revelation 14, 1 to 5, describes those who are victorious, and then backs up and tells us, how did they get on Mount Zion with the Lamb? Well, you have the three angels' message, and you have the second coming of Christ. So we're going to dive right into it. It's going to be an old-fashioned Bible study. We're going to look at it verse by verse. We're going to go through the first five verses of Revelation chapter 14, called the Lamb and the 144,000. So let's begin in verse 1. If you have your Bibles, you can follow along. You could look on the screen. John writes, "Then I looked, and behold, a Lamb standing on Mount Zion." Now, who's the Lamb in this verse? The Lamb is Jesus. The first mention that we have of lambs in the Bible, we find in Genesis chapter 21, there's an interesting story connected with it. Abraham's servants, they dug a well, but then there was a king by the name of Abimelech, whose servants confiscated the well that Abraham's servants had dug. And so there was a controversy that developed amongst Abimelech's servants and Abraham's servants. And so Abimelech and Abraham, they met. And then Abraham said, you know, this well that you claim is yours is actually my well. Abimelech said, oh, I didn't realize that. But then we find Abraham giving Abimelech seven lambs, the first mention of lambs in the Bible. You have mention of sheep earlier, but first reference to lambs. Here we have Abraham giving seven lambs to Abimelech to buy back something that belonged to Abraham in the beginning. So you have a well confiscated, but then the lambs buy back the well that really belonged to Abraham. And I find that interesting. Right at the beginning of a mention of lambs, of course, the lamb symbol of Jesus, the earth created by Christ belongs to Christ, but the adversary Satan, through the deception, Adam and Eve and the fall, took over the world, confiscated the world, and Jesus buys back the earth through his sacrifice as a lamb. So we find an interesting parallel in the first mention that we have of lambs. And of course, who is the lamb? John chapter 1, verse 29, it says, "The next day John saw Jesus coming towards him and said, 'Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world.'" Now, of course, the one who wrote these words, John, the disciple, he's also the one that wrote the book of Revelation. And in Revelation chapter 14, John sees the Lamb standing on Mount Zion. I can't help but wonder if John's mind was taken back to that day when he was standing by the Jordan and Jesus was baptized, and John the Baptist pointed to Jesus and said, "Behold the Lamb taking away the sins of the world." The next part of the verse talks about Mount Zion. What is Mount Zion? Originally, Zion was the hill on which the old Jebusite fortress was located that David had conquered and named the city of David. Eventually, the name changed to Jerusalem. And when the ark was transferred to Jerusalem, Zion became known as the dwelling place of God. So in Revelation, Zion is a symbol of the New Jerusalem. So Revelation 14:1 begins by describing God's people victorious in the New Jerusalem. They are standing there with Jesus. Revelation chapter 3, verse 12, this is a promise made to those who overcome. He overcomes, Jesus said, I will make him a pillar in the temple of my God, meaning that you'll have continual access into the presence of God, and he shall not go out no more, and I will write on him the name of my God and the name of the city of my God, which is the New Jerusalem, which comes down out of heaven from my God, and I will write on him my new name. So the home of the redeemed is a city. The name of the city is called the New Jerusalem. Revelation chapter 21 describes this beautiful city, which is going to be the capital of the kingdom, and it's going to be the home of the redeemed. Throughout the Old Testament, you have a story of two cities, two opposing cities. On the one hand, you have Jerusalem, which represents true worship. On the other hand, you have Babylon that represents false worship. And during Old Testament times, you have stories of battles that occurred between the inhabitants of Babylon and Jerusalem. And eventually Babylon conquered the Jerusalem and conquered the Jews. But then the Jews eventually, they were set free and they went back and rebuilt Jerusalem. And when we get to the book of Revelation, we have these same themes. We have Jerusalem, now the New Jerusalem, and we have Babylon also described in the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 17. We're going to get into what Babylon is in a later presentation, talking about the three angels' messages. The next part of verse 1, then I looked and behold a lamb standing on Mount Zion, and with him 144,000. Now, of course, 144,000, you do the math, it's 12 times 12 times 1,000, that's 144,000. Now, when we mention numbers in the Bible, especially in Bible prophecy, numbers have significance. What is the number 12 representing Bible prophecy? It represents the church. You have the 12 tribes of the Old Testament. You have the 12 apostles of the New Testament. Notice here you've got 12 times 12 times 1,000. This group is sort of a description of God's end-time apostles who have been given the work of taking God's last warning message to the world, and that message is the three angels' messages. So you've got 12 times 12 times 1,000. And when you're talking about a large number in the Bible, often the phrase is used 1,000 times 10,000 or thousands of thousands. It symbolizes a large group of people, or angels in some cases. And so you have God's remnant people in the last days doing this work of the apostles, last day apostles, meaning they're taking the gospel, they are preaching God's last warning message to the world. Now, a little bit more about the 144,000. Notice it says here that they are the ones who are able to stand through the events that are portrayed at the opening of the sixth seal. And we find this in Revelation chapter 6, beginning in verse 12. It says they have the seal of the living God, according to Revelation 7, and they are protected in a time of universal destruction when the seven last plagues are going to be poured out upon the earth. So let's just go and learn a little bit more about the 144,000. And to do that, we have to go to Revelation chapter 6, and we're going to begin here in verse 12. Revelation chapter 6, beginning in verse 12. And I looked, and when he had opened up the sixth seal, behold, there was a great earthquake. And the sun became black as sackcloth of hair, and the moon became like blood. So we have three events described at the opening of the sixth seal. The first is a great earthquake. That great earthquake has been identified as the Lisbon earthquake that occurred in 1755. Now, the date is significant because that is nearing the end of the 1260 years of papal supremacy that ended in 1798. So to announce the coming of that, of the end of that time period, 1755, you have the Lisbon earthquake, a very extensive earthquake. Then it's talking about the sun becoming black. That occurred in 1780. We call that the dark day, where in the middle of the day, it started to get really dark. And that night, the moon had the appearance of blood. And then it's talking about the falling of the stars. The great Leonid meteor shower occurred in 1833. So we've got these three significant events that occur at the opening of the sixth seal. And then the very next verse, which is verse 13, says, and the stars of heaven fell to the earth as a fig tree when it drops its late figs, when it is shaken with a mighty wind. Verse 14, then the sky receded as a scroll when it is rolled up, and every mountain and island was moved out of its place. So the previous verse, verse 13, talks about the falling of the stars, 1833. The next verse talks about the sky receding as a scroll, and you've got the second coming of Christ. So where are we living today? We're living between verse 13 and verse 14. That's where we are today. We have an end time warning message that has to go to the world just before Jesus comes. So the opening of the sixth seal brings us right up till the second coming of Christ. And a very important question is asked. Jesus is coming. And who's going to be able to stand when Jesus comes? Revelation chapter 7 answers the question about who's going to be able to stand when Jesus comes. And in Revelation chapter 7, you have a description of four angels that are holding back the four winds of earth. This is Revelation 7 verse 1. And an angel is seen coming from the east, and he has the seal of the living God. And he says to the four angels who are holding back the four winds of strife, he says, "Do not let the winds go until we have sealed the servants of God in their foreheads." And then John hears the number of those who are sealed, 144,000. It's the same group. So the same group that you find here in Revelation chapter 14, 1 through 5, is the same group described in Revelation chapter 7, the sealing of the 144,000. So the question is asked, when Jesus comes, who's going to be able to stand when Jesus comes? Those who have the seal of God in their foreheads. Friends, we want to be amongst those who have the seal of God when Jesus comes. We want to be able to look up and say, "This is our God. We have waited for him and he will save us." The wicked turn to the rocks and the mountains and they say, "Fall on us and hide us from the face of him that sits upon the throne. The great day of his wrath has come, and who shall be able to stand?" Now, there is great significance to the order in which John lists the tribes that we find in Revelation chapter 7. Each tribe has a specific meaning. And when you link the meaning of the names together, we have a description of the experience that God's people will go through just before the second coming of Christ. Now, how many tribes do we read about in the Old Testament? How many tribes made up Israel? There were 12 tribes. Of course, you got that number, which is significant. And you find in Revelation chapter 7 the tribes listed, but the order in which they are listed is unique. You don't find it anywhere else in Scripture. You'll also notice that one of the tribes is missing. The tribe of Dan is not listed in Revelation chapter 7. There's a reason for that. The Bible says that Dan is joined to his idols, leave him alone. You'll also notice that Joseph is mentioned, as well as in place of Ephraim. Now, Joseph had two sons, Manasseh, Ephraim. Ephraim, the tribe of Ephraim, was the largest tribe or the most important tribe of northern Israel, in the same way that Judah was the larger tribe of southern Israel. Sometimes the tribes of the north are referred to as Ephraim, just as the tribes of the south, which is Benjamin, Judah, and Levi, is referred to as Judah. And sometimes Ephraim, the tribe, is referred to by Ephraim's father, Joseph. So in the list that we're going to look at here in Revelation chapter 7, you'll notice Joseph is used in place of Ephraim. He's not there. Okay. Here we have the list of the tribes. It begins with the tribe of Judah. Judah was not the oldest of Jacob's sons, but the reason it starts with Judah is because Jesus came from the lineage of Judah. So you have Judah, and it means, "I will praise the Lord." Reuben, "He has looked on me." Gad, "and given good fortune." Asher, "Happy am I." Naphtali, "For my wrestling." Manasseh, "God is making me forget." Simeon, "God hears me." Levi, "and is joined to me." Issachar, "He has purchased me." Zebulun, "a dwelling," and Joseph, "God shall add to me," Benjamin, "the son of his right hand." Now, that's the meaning of the names. Now, if you just read the meaning of the names without reading the names, this is what you have. "I will praise the Lord. He has looked upon me and given good fortune. Happy am I for my wrestling." Will God's people go through a time of trouble before Jesus comes? Will their faith be tested? Will they wrestle like Jacob? "Happy am I for my wrestling. God is making me forget. God hears me." Will God hear the prayers of his saints? "And has joined to me. He has purchased me a dwelling." Jesus said, "Let not your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house there are what? Many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again. He has prepared for me a dwelling. God shall add to me the son of his right hand. Who's the son of his right hand? It's Jesus. You see, the 144,000 is a name given to a group of people who have the seal of God in the last days. And they are the ones who are able to stand when Jesus comes. Now, somebody might ask, well, do you say, Pastor Ross, that only 144,000 are going to be alive and translated to heaven when Jesus comes? I don't think so. Matter of fact, Revelation chapter 7 goes on to describe a great multitude of people when Jesus comes a second time. So don't get hung up on the number, all right? Don't start doing the math and calculating and saying, well, 144,000, that's not so many, so what are my chances, you know, to be translated? No, it doesn't work that way. God is able to save to the uttermost those who come to him. Amen? So there's no excuse by saying, no, the number's already made up. No. God can save all who turn to him in faith. So 144,000 represent God's people in the last days, taking his end time message to the world. All right, back to Revelation 14, verse 1. It says they have the Father's name written on their foreheads. What's the significance about having the Father's name? In the Bible, a name is often synonymous with character. In Revelation chapter 7, verse 3, the 144,000 are sealed in their foreheads. There is a close connection between the seal of God and the Father's name. When applied to the 144,000, the seal and the name of God represent, number one, ownership, meaning that the 144,000, they belong to God. Number two, character. The 144,000 will reflect the character of Jesus. They have the seal in their foreheads. According to the book of Revelation, everyone is going to be marked. Either you're going to have the seal of God, and you're going to be able to stand when Jesus comes, or you're going to have the mark of the beast, and you'll turn to the mountains and the rocks and say, fall on us, hide us from the face of him that sits upon the throne. So two groups of people, everybody's marked at the end. Either with the seal of God reflecting the character of God, or marked with the mark of the beast reflecting the character of the beast power that the third angel warns us about in Revelation 14. Now the decision-making power is, of course, in the mind or in the forehead. To have the Father's name written on the forehead is to have the commandments of God written on the heart and in the mind by the Holy Spirit. This is the fulfillment of the new covenant promise. This is what God wants for his people. We read in Ezekiel chapter 36, God says, I will give you a new heart. Notice, who's the one that's doing this? God is doing this. He says, I will give you a new heart. I will put a new spirit within you. I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh. I will give you a heart of flesh. Verse 27, I will put my spirit within you and cause you to walk in my statutes, and you will keep my judgments and do them. What's being described here in Ezekiel chapter 36 is a group of people that have the Father's name written in their foreheads. They have the seal of God. They have the Spirit of God. They are staying faithful to God in the last days, a time of widespread apostasy. They are standing like Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, saying, we're going to be faithful to God no matter what. God's looking for men and women who are willing to allow him to write his law upon their hearts. Verse 2, and I heard a voice from heaven. John describes 38 times in the book of Revelation what he hears and 78 times what he sees. In other words, Revelation is an eye and ear report of what John saw and heard in vision. Now, it's amazing to me. This book of Revelation is an incredible book. Revelation chapter 1, we read, the revelation of Jesus Christ, which God gave to him to show to his servants things that must shortly take place. Notice the sequence. It's the revelation of Jesus. It is a revealing of Jesus. Both that which is revealed is Jesus, and the one doing the revealing is Jesus. But this revelation comes through Christ from the Father. It comes to his servants, the prophets, and it reveals to us things that must take place, and he sent and signified it by his angel to his servant John. So God the Father is the fountainhead of all truth. This truth is conveyed through Christ by an angel to John on the island of Patmos. And in vision, John would see things. And in vision, John would hear things. And whatever John saw, he wrote it down. Whatever he heard, he wrote it down. Whatever the Spirit of God revealed to him, he wrote that down. So the book of Revelation is a direct message coming from heaven, coming from God, for God's people in the last days. If ever there is a book that we need to be studying and living and sharing, it's Revelation. It's God's end time book, end time message that has to go to the world. Verse 2 says, speaking of John, who bore witness of the word of God, the things he heard, the testimony of Jesus, that's the spirit of prophecy, and all that he saw in vision. So he heard a voice from heaven like the voice of many waters. Jesus has the voice of many waters in Revelation 1:15. And like the voice of loud thunder, thunder is often associated or connection with the presence of God in the book of Revelation. And the last part of the verse says, and I heard the sound of harpists playing their harps. John now hears the 144,000 playing their harps and singing of their experience of deliverance. They have the seal of God. They have gone through the time of trouble. God has sustained them. The second coming has occurred. They've been translated to heaven. Now they are with the Lamb in heaven, and they are singing their praises to God, and they are getting to play these special heavenly harps. Verse 3 tells us what they sing. It says they sang, as it were, a new song. Now the reason they are singing this new song, it's the song of Moses and the Lamb, and it will be sung by the 144,000 who have stood with Jesus on the earth, and now they are standing with Jesus in heaven. They have gained the victory. So what is the song that the 144,000 will sing in heaven? It's the song of Moses and the Lamb. We find in Revelation chapter 15, verse 2 and 3. And I saw something like a sea of glass mingled with fire. Those who have gotten the victory over the beast and over the image of, and over his image and over the mark and over the number of his name, standing on the sea of glass, having the harps of God, and they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, and they sing the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are your works, Lord God Almighty, just and true are your ways, O King of saints. Now notice the two parts of the song that they sing. They sing the song of Moses and the song of the Lamb. Now can you think of the song of Moses? You know, it's interesting to note that there is a part of the book of Deuteronomy, actually a large section of the book of Deuteronomy, that's referred to as the Song of Moses, and really it is Moses' recounting of God's deliverance of Israel. So when you think about the Song of Moses, you're really thinking about God delivering his people. And the high point of that deliverance is after God brought them up out of Egypt and was leading to the promised land, and they came up against the Red Sea, mountains on either side, the sea in front of them, the Egyptian armies coming behind. It looked as though they were doomed. They couldn't defend themselves. All they could do was to cry out to God for deliverance. And in the last moment, God opens up the Red Sea and they pass through on dry land. And their enemy is destroyed. God's people in the last days will face a similar situation. According to Revelation chapter 13, before Jesus comes, there is a death decree that is passed against those who are keeping God's commandments. And like the children of Israel standing at the Red Sea, God's people in the last days will have to depend completely upon Jesus for deliverance. And just like opening up the Red Sea so the children of Israel could be delivered from their enemies, in the last moment Jesus comes. You see, that death decree is never enacted because Jesus opens up the sky and he comes to deliver his people. And just like the wicked Egyptians were destroyed in the Red Sea, so the wicked are destroyed with the brightness of Christ coming when Jesus comes to deliver his own. Thus they sing the song of Moses. That's their experience. They sing the song of the Lamb. Do you know anywhere in the Bible that talks about Jesus singing? Well, we know Jesus sang, without a doubt. Even as a young man, I'm sure he sang in the carpenter shop. There is one account that we do have in Scripture of Jesus singing with his disciples. And it's mentioned in the upper room just before the Garden of Gethsemane. It says they sang a hymn and then they departed. And of course, it was then in the Garden of Gethsemane where Jesus, bearing the sins of the world, cried out and he said, my God, if it is possible, let this cup pass. Nevertheless, not my will, thy will be done. So the song of the Lamb is that cry, not my will, thy will be done. God's people of the last days will need to have that same spirit of full surrender, trusting in Jesus, saying, Lord, not my will, thy will be done, even if it means a cross. Even if I have to go through the valley of the shadow of death, I will trust in you. Thy will be done. So if this group of people, 144,000, this end time group will have the seal of God in their foreheads. They have that experience. Next part of the verse says they are standing before the throne. The throne has earlier been introduced as the throne of God, throne of the Father in Revelation chapter 4, verse 2. This new song sung by the 144,000 is in the presence of the Lamb and the Father. Now, not only do we find the 144,000 and all the redeemed and the angels singing praises to God, but the Bible also tells us that God will also sing. So not only are we singing praises to God, but the Bible tells us that God is going to sing for joy over the redeemed. This is an incredible verse. It's one that we don't go to too often, but here it is, Zephaniah chapter 3, verse 17. It says, the Lord your God is in your midst. It's talking about the redeemed in heaven. The mighty one will save. Yes, he has saved. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Oh, can you imagine the scene? Standing on the sea of glass before the throne of God. And there we are. Jesus has brought us into the presence of his Father. And we look into the face of God the Father. And Jesus says, Lord, says, Father, here are the ones that you have given me. Here they are. And we sing for joy in the presence of the Father. But then I just imagine that as we stand in that heavenly throne, then there is a hush that comes over the crowd. And every eye is turned to the Father seated upon his throne. When the Father looks at you and he looks at me, he looks at the redeemed. His heart is so filled with joy that he can stay silent no longer. And there is this deep, rolling, majestic, beautiful song that the Father sings because his children has finally come home. Amen. Oh, friends, could you imagine being in the presence of the Father and hearing the Creator God sing for joy because of you and me? I tell you, friends, if heaven ends right there, that's enough. That's good enough for me. Wow. Hear the Father sing for joy. So before we even talk about the beast, and before we talk about Babylon being fallen, before we talk about God's last warning message, Revelation 14 begins by describing the reward of the redeemed. They're in the presence of God. They're singing for joy because finally they are home. They are home. That is our reward. Being in God's presence. Of course, in Revelation chapter 14, verse 3, not only is it talking about being in front of the throne, that's God's throne, it talks about the four living creatures. You might be wondering, who are the four living creatures? What we find in Revelation chapter 4, a description of the four living creatures, these are angelic beings. The first is likened unto a lion. Of course, Jesus is described as the lion of the tribe of Judah, a calf. A calf was a beast of burden. When Jesus came to our earth, he came to bear our sins, to die a sacrifice. Calves were used for sacrifices. The third is a face of a man. When Jesus rose from the dead, he ascended up to heaven. He is now the Son of Man glorified. He is our representative in heaven. And then when Jesus comes again, he comes as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. An eagle in the Bible is often associated with speed. It's associated with judgment. Jesus comes to deliver his saints and to judge the wicked. So even the four living creatures that we find described in Revelation chapter 4 is a description of different phases of the ministry of Jesus. We see this, of course, in the camp of Israel. I don't have time to get into all of the details, but God gave strict instructions as to how the Israelites were to pitch their tents around the sanctuary. And there were three tribes on either side, making up the total of 12. And each of the tribes would have a leading tribe. So you have three on each side, and amongst those three, there was a leading tribe. And the tribes would pitch tent with their banners, and they each had a banner. And their banner was to face towards the sanctuary. Now, it's amazing to me that you read here in Numbers, it gives you the description of how the tribes were to be pitched around the sanctuary and which was the leading tribe. You notice here it says, and on the east side, towards the rising of the sun, those of the standard of the forces of Judah. So the banner facing the sanctuary was the tribe of Judah, at least on that east side. And what do you suppose is the symbol of the tribe of Judah? A lion. The next one on the south side shall be the standard of the forces of Reuben. What do you suppose was the symbol of the tribe of Reuben? It was a calf. And on the west side, the standard of the forces of Ephraim, what do you think was the symbol of the tribe of Ephraim? It was a man. And the standard of the forces of Dan shall be on the north. And what do you think was the symbol of the tribe of Dan? You can guess, an eagle. So looking down from heaven at the camp of Israel in their wilderness wanderings surrounding the sanctuary, it's as if you even get a miniature of what John describes in Revelation chapter 4, the four living creatures surrounding God's throne in heaven. You see a reflection of that, even in the camp of Israel. The next group that's described sitting around God's throne are the elders. We read about this in Revelation chapter 4. There are two suggestions as to the identity of the 24 elders. Number one, they are the ones who are resurrected at the time of Christ's resurrection, and they were taken to heaven. The other suggestion is that these are created beings from other worlds that have not sinned. And we have a couple of scriptures. So the first idea is they're the ones who were resurrected at the time of Christ's resurrection. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 52, we read, and the graves were opened, and many of the bodies of the saints who had fallen asleep were raised. And coming out of their graves after his resurrection, they went into the holy city and appeared to many. Now, this is about all the reference that we have of this group of people that were resurrected at the time of Christ's resurrection. They appeared in Jerusalem, and then we don't hear anything more about them. You don't read about them in the book of Acts. They're not involved in the church. So it makes sense that this group of people, they were taken to heaven with Jesus as first fruits of the resurrection. Matter of fact, we have this verse over here in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 8. It says, therefore he says, when he ascended on high, talking about the ascension of Jesus, he led captivity captive and gave gifts unto men. Those who were held captive by the grave, they were delivered and they were taken to heaven when Jesus ascended. So some say, well, maybe the 24 elders is that group of people, those who were resurrected. But there's another idea. Could they be this group? Job chapter 1, verse 6. Now there was a day when the sons of God came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came amongst them. Now when it's talking about these sons of God, it's talking about the representatives of the unfallen worlds. We know that our world is not the only inhabited world out there, but God has got other worlds with other intelligent created beings. No, they don't come visit us in UFOs, although they know what's going on. They're observing things happening on the earth, but these are intelligent beings. And there are representatives of these worlds, and there is this general gathering that occurred that we read about in the book of Job. We also find in Isaiah chapter 24, verse 23, it says, then the moon will be disgraced and the sun ashamed, for the Lord of hosts will reign on Mount Zion in Jerusalem and before his elders gloriously. Interesting, here we have a reference once again to the elders, the representatives possibly of these unfallen worlds. Now I'm going to tell you which idea I like. I think it's the representatives of the unfallen worlds. And the reason I say that is in Revelation chapter 4, you have a description of the heavenly throne room, and it describes God the Father seated upon the throne, and it talks about the four living creatures, and it talks about the 24 elders. And it's not until you get to chapter 5 that suddenly Jesus appears as a lamb as it had been slain. So the picture is portrayed in Revelation chapter 4 of the heavenly throne room, but somebody is missing. It's not until chapter 5 that you find Jesus entering into the scene. So if the 24 elders are those who were resurrected at the time of Christ's resurrection, they shouldn't be waiting for Jesus in heaven. They should be coming along with Jesus. Are you with me? So could the 24 elders be the representatives of the unfallen worlds? Yes, I think so. Notice the statement in the book Desire of Ages. It says, as he ascended,
talking about the ascension of Christ, he led the way. And the multitude of captives set free at his resurrection followed. Okay, those are the ones who were resurrected. There is the throne, she's describing what's happening in heaven. And around the rainbow of promise, there are the cherubim and the seraphim, that's the four living creatures, the commanders of the angelic host. Then she says, the sons of God, the representatives of the unfallen worlds are assembled, the heavenly council before which Lucifer had accused God and his son, the representatives of that sinless realm over which Satan had thought to establish his dominion, all are there to welcome their Redeemer. So when you look at that quote and you put together some of the other pieces, it seems to make sense, at least to me, that these 24 elders would represent, are the representatives of the unfallen worlds. They're there in heaven waiting for Jesus as he ascended after the resurrection. All right, back to verse 3. It said, no one can learn this song except the 144,000 who were redeemed from the earth. This song is sung by those who have stood firm for Jesus in the final moments of earth's history. They are taken to heaven without tasting death. This song is an expression of their experience, thus only the 144,000 are able to sing it because it describes their experience. It says they were redeemed from the earth, they are taken to heaven, they are translated without seeing death at the second coming of Christ. Of course, we have this group described in Revelation chapter 7, verse 13. It says, then one of the elders answered, saying to me, who are these arrayed in white robes? Where did they come from? And he said unto me, sir, you know. And he said, these are the ones who have come out of great tribulation, and they've washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Now translated to heaven. Verse 4, it says, these are the ones who were not defiled with woman, for they are virgins. Now in Bible typology, a woman represents the church. This is a group of people who are true and faithful to Jesus. There are two women described in Revelation. Revelation chapter 12, you have a description of a pure woman. Revelation 17, you have a description of a corrupt woman. Here is a group of people who are holding to the truths of God's word. They have not given in to the false man-made traditions and doctrines of the apostate churches or the apostate powers. In that sense, they are described as virgins. It symbolized purity of faith. That's what's being described here. Revelation chapter 12, 17. And the dragon was enraged with the woman and went to make war with the remnant of her offspring who keep the commandments of God and they have the testimony of Jesus. This is God's end time remnant people. It says they follow the Lamb wherever he goes. If we want to follow the Lamb in heaven, we need to begin by following the Lamb on earth. Amen. He's following Jesus now. That enables us to follow Jesus when he comes. And here we have a promise to those who do follow the Lamb. They shall neither hunger anymore nor thirst. The sun shall not strike them nor any heat, for the Lamb who is in the midst of the throne would shepherd them and lead them to living fountains of water, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. Jesus has come and he has taken them, and they are finally home. It says, these are redeemed from among men. They are first fruits to God and to the Lamb. They are translated without seeing death. What does it mean that they are first fruits to God? The 144,000 may be considered as first fruits in the sense of being the first part of a larger harvest and a special gift for Christ. Those who have stood faithful at the very end, true to God. Verse 5, our last verse. It says, in their mouth was found no deceit. Now, it doesn't mean, if you look at the original Greek, it doesn't mean that they've never sinned, but at some point of judgment, they are found to be faithful to Jesus. They have stood true. You find in Daniel chapter 7, verse 9, I don't have time to read all the verses. We'll talk about this later on in our Three Angels series, but Daniel chapter 7 talks about a judgment that occurs in heaven. This group of people at the end of time, they have lived during that pre-Advent judgment, and when their name has come up in the judgment, they have stood for Jesus, their sins have been washed away, they've been covered with Christ's robe of righteousness, they have the seal of the living God, and they are standing faithful to Jesus in these final moments of earth's history. Thus, in Revelation chapter 22, Jesus says, he who is unjust, let him be unjust still. He who is filthy, let him be filthy still. He who is righteous, let him be righteous still. And he that is holy, let him be holy still. You know, at the beginning of this special summit weekend, I thought it would be appropriate for us, and those who are watching, you're welcome to join us too, before we get into the deep parts of Bible prophecy, that we just recommit our hearts to Jesus. Amen. As I mentioned, there's two groups in Revelation. The one has the seal of God. The other has the mark of the beast. Every single one of us, if life should last, will find ourselves in one of those two groups, either with the seal of the living God or the mark of the beast. We want to have God's character written on our hearts and on our minds, His law written within us. You know, I've asked John if he would just come. Where is John? Maybe he'll come. He's going to sing a verse of a song. And while he sings, we want to give you an opportunity in your own heart. Send up a little prayer and say, you know, Lord, I want to start fresh with you in this series. I want to make sure that your Spirit is working on my heart. Listen to the words.
And let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy
Dear Father in heaven, we want Jesus to write His law upon our hearts. Father, we don't want self. We want Jesus. We want the love of Christ to shine through in all that we do. Father, keep us faithful to You. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We want to thank you all for joining us. Thank you, John, for playing. Thank you, Michelle. What a start to a great Bible study weekend. Again, I want to remind you, we'll continue tomorrow morning at 10 o'clock. Plan to stay for the whole day. We got lunch taken care of. We got meetings in the afternoon. We even taken care of supper for you tomorrow. So make sure you're here at 10 o'clock tomorrow morning. Very important presentation. God bless. Have a safe trip home, and we'll see you early in the morning.